So how we doing this morning, Cross Point? Average. We're average this morning. We are sons and daughters of the one true King. We should be super. Amen. Anybody super this morning? There we go. Much better. And so that was way more super than the bowl that we saw last week. Amen. Whoo. I really didn't think I was going to be telling all the truth when I said that the snacks would be the best part of the evening, but the snacks and the commercials, I think, are what pulled everybody through that game. Hey, the Olympics going on, too. Woo! Yeah. Okay, four people watched that, and so not really a lot going on with that, but hey, I do want to tell you about the Super Tub. The Super Tub is coming in 3 weeks, so be ready. The Super Tub will be the Sunday when we collect the bottles of blessing. And we're going to bring a tub about this tall and about this wide. And we're going to fill it with all of our change for Caring Hearts Pregnancy Center and Support Life. And last year, that was an amazing day. Just seeing people go by and do that. So if you haven't got those, pick those up. That is going to be a great, great time going by and putting the change in there. So any guy know what next Friday is? Oh, okay, the Lord just changed the message this morning. So, woo, yeah. Valentine's Day. So if you say you forgot, it's not on me. It's on you. That's on you. It's always a good time to get somebody else some candy or to buy yourself some candy. So if you are going to buy some, Saturday might be the better deal. So because it'll probably be half off during that time. Lots to celebrate in February. Lots to celebrate. Love the big thing. And talking about love and all the things that go along with love. Puppy love. In love. True love. That's right. God's love. I mean, wouldn't you like to have a penny for every rose that would be sent in the United States next week? Woo! Or a dime on every dollar that's spent next week. When we think about that and we think about what all that represents, as lovely as it is, there's no truer love than God's love and God's faithfulness. And so we're beginning a series in the book of Ruth. Some of you may be very familiar with that. Some of you maybe aren't so familiar. But there are some truths that come out of this book that I want us to share during this month. And there's just a lot of things that jump out at you. So many things, so many good things that come out of this book. So many areas and situations that are kind of where we are right now, if we think about it. And so this morning, as we prepare to just dig right in, we're going to be talking about Naomi, Ruth's mother-in-law, and the situation that they were in. So if you have your Bible this morning, turn to Ruth chapter 1, just after the book of Judges. Ruth chapter 1. And we find that Naomi was married, and she had two sons. Her husband passed away. And so he left her a widow, and then about 10 years later, both sons passed away. So she was all alone, except for her two daughters-in-law. And so she was at a place where, as a widow, she didn't have any relatives in Moab, and she wasn't sure her husband had any relatives in Israel, so she didn't know where to go. She didn't know what to do. Do I stay here where I know no one, go back to Judah hoping someone is there that my husband knows? I don't know. But I've got these two daughters-in-law with me, and they're hanging out with me. And we begin in verse 6 of chapter 1. It says, "Then Naomi heard in Moab that the Lord had blessed his people in Judah by giving them good crops again." You see, this time period in the Judges were one in which the people, the Israelites, would be with God and hang out with God for a while, and they were really tight with God, and then they would go completely the other way. And then a judge would come and say, "Hey, you guys are going to have to get it back together." And they would for a while. And then they would go back the other direction. So it's this period of darkness and just not doing what God had called them to do. And so that's where they were in the midst of a famine. And so she learned that there were going to be good crops again. And so she said, "Hey, this is what we need to do." So Naomi and her daughters-in-law got ready to leave Moab to return to her homeland. When her two daughters-in-law, with her two daughters-in-law, she set out from the place where she had been living, and they took the road that would lead them back to Judah. But on the way, Naomi said to her two daughters-in-law, "Go back to your mother's homes, and may the Lord reward you for your kindness to your husbands," her sons, "and to me. May the Lord bless you with the security of another marriage." Then she kissed them goodbye, and they all broke down and wept. "No," they said, "we want to go with you to your people." But Naomi replied, "Why should you go on with me? Can I still give birth to other sons who could grow up to be your husbands? No, my daughters, return to your parents' homes, for I am too old to marry again. And even if it were possible, and I were to get married tonight and bear sons, then what? Would you wait for them to grow up and refuse to marry someone else? No, of course not. Things are far more bitter for me than for you, because the Lord himself has raised his fist against me." And again they wept together, and Orpah kissed her mother-in-law goodbye, but Ruth clung tightly to Naomi. "Look," Naomi said to her, "your sister-in-law has gone back to her people and to her gods. You should do the same." But Ruth replied, "Don't ask me to leave you and turn back. Wherever you go, I will go. Wherever you live, I will live. Your people will be my people, and your God will be my God. Wherever you die, I will die, and there I will be buried. May the Lord punish me severely if I allow anything but death to separate us." When Naomi saw that Ruth was determined to go with her, she said nothing more. So the two of them continued on their journey. When they came to Bethlehem, the entire town was excited by their arrival. "Is it really Naomi?" the women asked. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for your word this morning. God, I pray that you would just help us to glean from it that which would pierce our own individual hearts and the heart of this church. God, I pray that you would just move mightily among your people. Lord, help us to stay focused on your word and just pierce our hearts. Father, we pray in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. So this time of being a widow was a tough time. Being a widow, being a widower is never easy. But in this time of history, widows were one of two things usually. Either ignored and not taken care of, or taken advantage of. Either ignored or taken advantage of because they had no man to stand up for them. They had no one to take care of them, no one to create a living for them. So they were just kind of out there. With Naomi's situation, she had no relatives in one place. Not sure if she travels, there will even be a redeemer, a kinsman redeemer there, a relative of her husband. Nobody knows. So what do we do? As we look through those scriptures, we know that she had a selfless love. She wanted to make sure those girls were taken care of for their kindness to her sons. And she knew that even though it would be great for her to have company and not be alone, she thought of them more and she said, "Go back to your own homes. Go back to your mothers. Because I have nothing left to offer you." Now, we believe and we understand and we share with our children, you can always do what? You can always come. You can always come home. You can always come home. The great Jerry Clower, great theologian, just kidding. Jerry Clower used to say, when your children move out of the house, don't be upset, don't cry, because they're coming back and they're bringing more with them. And he was right, wasn't he? But we always say, you can come home. So she was saying, hey, you need to go back to your own home. I have nothing else for you. And she tried her very best to convince them. You see, there was a time that they wept together. There was a time that they all felt that pain and anguish of loss together, for these two daughters-in-law were now widows also. And so they cried and wept together after that. And again, she said, hey, you need to go on back to your own homes. And Orpah said okay, kissed her goodbye, and went on her way. Ruth was different. Ruth said, I just don't think that's what we need to do. I don't think that's how it's supposed to be. You see, Ruth was a Moabite. She did not worship the one true God. Naomi was her influence in that. And it says at the end of verse 14, but Ruth clung tightly to Naomi. So I want you to get the picture here. One is already gone. The other one is hanging on tightly saying, I'm not going. I am not going. And then verse 15, Naomi has to speak the truth in love. She said, look, your sister-in-law has gone back to her people and to her gods. You should do the same. Basically, hands on the shoulder, it's time for you to go. And Ruth replied, don't ask me to leave you and turn back. And that's when she tells her, wherever you go, I'm going. Wherever you live, I'll live. Whoever your people are, those will be my people. Where you die, I will die. Where you are buried, I'll be buried. Now that's sticking with somebody, isn't it? She said, hey, that's what I'm going to do. And then furthermore, may the Lord severely punish me if I don't do all that, if I don't keep my promise. And so when Naomi saw that Ruth was determined to go with her, she said nothing more. That was it. She said, I'm sticking with you. I'm going to be stuck like glue. Nothing you can do. And that's it. Have you ever had that happen before where you try your best to tell somebody something and they won't listen to what you want? And so you just say nothing else. Stop murmuring and whispering. Yeah, you do that every day. You don't ever listen to what I say, do you? So you just decide you're not going to say anything. Maybe you're buying the meal or someone else is purchasing the meal at a restaurant. No, let me get it. No, I'm going to get it. No, let me get it. No, I'm going to get it. And then you go, okay. Next time we go to Mickey D's, I'll buy. Okay? Dollar menu. But we'll have a time where somebody says, no, this is the way I really, really, really want to do that. And we say, okay. And we let it go. That's what happened here. Now, Naomi spoke the truth in love. But her pain is evident in how she speaks. She wanted them to go. But in her heart of hearts, she knew she would be alone. And so, when Ruth said, hey, I'm staying, I know that that made her feel much more comfortable. See, Naomi truly loved those girls because that was the connection to her sons and to her husband. She was heartbroken as well, just like they were. And we've all been there. You see, Ruth would wind up worshiping the one true God because of her relationship with Naomi and because she stuck with her. Because you'll notice she said, go back to your mother's homes and the gods of your people. So it wasn't the one true God. So Naomi had to speak the truth in love and say, okay, here's what needs to happen. But if that doesn't happen, if you're not going to go, okay, I'll say nothing more. We'll travel together. Go where there is food. We'll go where there is food. But let's look at some things about Ruth. Just some one-word descriptors. She too was a widow. She was displaced. She really had nowhere to go either, because what if she gets back home and her parents aren't there? Her home is no longer her home. Something has happened. It wasn't like she could shoot an email and say, hey, I'll be home in 2 days. It wasn't like she could text or make a phone call and say, hey, are you guys still at the same place? It's been a while. But this was a love that she knew. So she was displaced. She was broken. If you ever had that gut-wrenching, heart-breaking, sobbing, can't-stop pain that just breaks you sometimes, that's what she was feeling. She was lost. And she was in need of this relationship with Naomi. And Naomi, admitting it or not, was in need of that relationship as well. Now, based on what we've read this morning, would you say that Ruth was somewhat strong-willed? Okay, that'd be a yes or a no question. Would you say Ruth was strong-willed? There you go. Yes. She was. Because she said, you can say whatever you want. I'm not going. I'm going to stay with you. Now, there are a lot of things written about strong-willed children and how we handle them. They're typically other people's children, not your own. But when we think about that, when we think about Ruth and her demeanor, in this moment, we need to understand that it was her spirit and strength and will to stay with her that wound up making this whole thing possible. Now, when we have strong-willed children, we want to make sure they are obedient. We want to make sure they understand who the authority is, right? You're not sure, are you? I challenge you not to break the spirit but channel the strength. You see, that's what happened here. Who is going to be a leader who is going to make changes in the world? Who is going to be a leader who will make changes to lead people to Christ in the future when it looks much different than it does now? Someone with a strong will. Someone who's willing to stand up. Someone who's willing to say, hey, here am I, send me. Use me. Makes no difference what other people think. Use me. So rather than break the spirit, Naomi chose to channel the strength. Strong people make it in tough times through faith and the Father. And I would say this was a tough time. Maybe you've been at a place in your life where you have just felt broken, where you have felt like there's nowhere else to turn. I am hurting so badly. There's nothing else I can do. There's nowhere else to go. God, I don't even know how to pray. Ever been there with an amen? I don't even know how to pray. I don't even know what to pray. This is just such a time of loss. I don't even know. But with faith in the Father, people make it. You try to do it on your own, and it's so much harder. So with each other, they made it. See, there has to be love and a leader and faith and a follower. When there's love and a leader and faith and followers, that's when God weaves all this together and says, okay, let me take care of you. Let me lead you. Let me show you the way. Let me help you. And so this morning, there are three things that I want to make sure that we take out of this message. And the first one is, Naomi accepted the situation. She accepted the situation. Have you ever gotten news or been informed of something that has happened that you really can't believe? And it tears you apart. And you have no idea how to react. Our first thought is, this cannot be happening. This can't be real. I've been a part of many of those situations. Many times having to be the messenger. And it is so hard. But at some point in time, we either accept the situation and we move forward, or we stay there. Because remember, the circumstances do not define you. Circumstances do not define you. You are in them, but they are not who you are. So she said, okay, I will accept this situation. And I will accept that one daughter-in-law has gone back to her home and one daughter-in-law is with me. I will accept that. The second thing is, she assessed the situation. Okay, I'm going to accept the situation. I can't change it. She couldn't bring her husband back. She couldn't bring her sons back. But she said, now what? Let me see what God would have me to do. It would be best if I sent these young women back to their own homes, because there they might remarry. That is my prayer, that they would have strength, they would have comfort, they would have someone to take care of them, someone to protect them. That would be what was best. So that's what I feel led to do and share. And so she did. She assessed the situation. But then finally, And first and foremost, she didn't stay in the situation. Naomi did not stay in the situation. She said, these are the circumstances. I've accepted it. I have assessed it. We're in the middle of a famine, but I hear there are crops and there is food. We are going. We are moving. You see, in life, we must keep moving. If we sit still, we will either be passed by or run over. Amen? You must keep moving. And so she decided not to do something many times we do. If you have ever been in a set of circumstances where it is tough, you don't want to be a part of it, you have no choice, sometimes we throw a party. Anybody know what kind of party we throw? A pity party. You know who we invite? Nobody. And we can sink into such a depression. We can sink into such a place that we forget who God is, how big He is, and what He can do for us. We can sink to such a low in that pity party that nobody can pull us out. And our circumstances not only become who we are, they control us. And so, we cannot stay in the situation. We've got to keep moving. And one of the ways to keep moving and get out of that is to not be concerned with yourself, but others. Could she be hurting anymore, having lost her husband and two sons? No. She sends her daughters-in-law away. She didn't think about herself. See, it's easier to stay in a state of depression and stay low and stay down here and my life is horrible and everyone else has the greatest life ever when we stay in our situation, when we have a pity party, when we don't move. But the easiest way to take that first step out is find somebody else and help them. Find someone who is in a tougher spot than you and help them. Naomi and Ruth built a relationship they could each count on. Strong-willed became a strong bond. Strong-willed became a strong bond. You see, we have choices. God is a God of free will, and He's given us choices. And even though Naomi experienced so much loss, she still chose to serve God, no matter what. You say, yeah, but that was in Bible times. It's not that tough today. Talk to people who have experienced such loss. And you will see that it always, always makes people go one of two directions. It either makes you bitter or better. Always. I'm privileged to know a man and have for some time. One of the godliest men I know. I know lots of godly men, but he is a godly man. I was able to have dinner with him as he celebrated his 75th birthday. just this week. On the outside, you would say, wow, what an awesome guy, has it all together. Family is great. Been married 50 plus years. Wow. He has buried 3 children. But he serves God anyway. He loves God anyway. He didn't stay in those situations. The circumstances didn't define him. He is a follower of Christ. And that is our hope. So here we see the same thing. We put the mirror that we look into on ourselves and say, hey, I want to make that change and move that mirror and put in a window and look and see how I can help someone else. So that situation could have been horrible. The loss and the pain. Naomi and Ruth could have gone on for years and just said, oh, I know, I'm miserable, aren't you? Yes. And besides that, you're my mother-in-law. Oh. Some of you laughed about your mother-in-laws. How many mother-in-laws do we have in here? Not many admitting to it. We're going to start talking about the son-in-laws and the daughter-in-laws here shortly. Yeah, well, I wouldn't, you know, I don't want anybody to know that he's my, See, they didn't allow that pain and bitterness to be permanent. I said, you know what, this is where we are now. It's not where we have to stay. The relationship they shared, commitment to each other and to God, the kindness, the love that will come in the next few weeks as we learn about, is amazing. And considering the time when it was that people, much like our times now, in that period of judges, it was, if I think it's right and it works for me, I'm going to do it anyway, regardless of what God says. Sound familiar? And so for them to have that commitment to each other and to the Lord is simply amazing. But you know, we can do the same thing. We can do the same thing because the God we serve turns tragedy into triumph. And when we're committed to Him, and we're stuck like glue, we're not going anywhere, that's when He rewards us. That's when He says, you know what? Even though it hurts, even though it's painful, you are faithful. I am the healer. I will take care of you. God isn't going anywhere. God hasn't gone anywhere. Have you? So this morning, I don't know where you are. I don't know the pain that you deal with. I don't know the loss that you have. Some folks in our church just this morning have experienced the loss of a dad and a grandfather. We need to lift them up in prayer. But you may have something from your past that you have been dragging with you for years that you need to let go of and say, God, me and you, stuck like glue. I'm not going anywhere. This time it's for real. This time I'm with you. This time I'm committed. And I want to do those 3 things today. I want to accept where I am. I'm going to assess the situation, but I'm not going to stay in that. I'm going to keep moving. So whatever that is for you this morning, I would invite you just to come and lay it all down right here. And if you say, you know what? I don't have a relationship with Christ. I don't have a relationship with the Lord of Lords, the King of Kings. And maybe that day is today for you as well. Would you pray with me? Father, I pray this morning in the strong name of Jesus that you have given us the things in our heart that we need to let go of right here at the front of this auditorium. Father, I pray that you would pierce our hearts to leave this place, not allowing our circumstances to define us, but that you would, through the love that you have so graciously poured out upon us, through your Son Jesus, move us forward. Move us forward as individuals and as a church together, and leaving no one behind, but tracking together to change the world and further the kingdom. And Father, there's one person here that doesn't know you. Lord, I pray you would just convict them this morning that they would not leave this place until they are in a right relationship with you. And Lord, we just want to take this time right now to take a stand and just praise you and let go of this stuff that's holding us back. In Jesus' name, amen.